This course is all about performance. And what you just saw was how we can plot execution time as a function of the problem size. Now, if you had a car, then you could, of course, plot how long it takes to go a certain distance. So you might create a graph where you say, I've gone a certain distance, what is the time required to get there? And it might even be something linear like that. But you may want to impress your friends about the average speed with which you traveled, which especially if that's a high number would impress people. So what you then may do instead is to say, let's plot still distance along the x-axis, but let's instead over here plot distance traveled divided by time. And if you took calculus, then you would know, or even if you just took algebra, you would know that if this is a straight line, then distance divided by time would turn out to be some kind of constant, and that constant would then somehow represent speed. So we're going to do the same thing with the data that we collected. So what have you done so far? You have plotted the sizes of the matrices along the x-axis. And in our experiments, we usually take all of the matrices to be square. So m is equal to n is equal to k. And then we plotted the execution time along the y-axis. And we ended up with some kind of curve that roughly looked something like that. And how can we explain this? Well, we know that we're doing a matrix-matrix multiply. So we're taking a matrix C, and we're updating it by doing A times B. And we're adding the result of that to the original matrix. And if this matrix is M by N, this matrix is M by K, and then B is K by N, so we have C, A, and B. Then what do we know? Well, our triple nested loop says to compute a typical entry in our matrix C, we have to do a dot product of the corresponding row with the correct column. And that dot product requires a multiply and an add for each pair of entries. So that requires 2k floating point operations. But we have to compute m times n entries in C, or rather we need to update them. So we need to do m times n times 2k floating point operations. And of course we can rearrange that and we get 2 times m times n times k flops. And then if m is equal to n is equal to k and we parameterize it by n, then we would expect time to be proportional to n cubed. Right? If instead here we would have plotted the flops required, then it would be 2n cubed. And we're making the assumption here that a floating point operation takes constant time. All right, but that's not really what we want. We want to know the rate at which we compute, because later we're going to see that we can check what the peak performance of chip is in terms of the rate with which it can compute floating point operations. And therefore, we want to take this formula right here and say, instead of being concerned about the flops performed, let's worry about the flops per second that are being performed. In other words, what we want to do is we want to take the total number of operations that are being performed, the total number of floating point operations, and we want to divide that by time in seconds, and then we get the rate with which we compute. Now, it turns out that a modern CPU can do billions of floating point operations per second, so this would always be a really large number, and therefore we multiply that times 10 to the minus 9th, because then we are measuring billions of floating point operations per second. And billions of floating point operations per second, the unit for that is gigaflops. Giga, billions, floating point operations per second. So let's go ahead and let's see what happens if we plot this instead.